Hey gang, we're going to spend the rest of the course talking about one sense at a time, first taste, then smell, etc. But before we do that, I want to use today to really emphasize the fact that the senses are deeply interconnected. I want to kind of complicate the idea that it's even reasonable to talk about or think about the senses separately. So this will help to reinforce one of the themes of this class, that no sense is an island. You read in the Rosenblum article that the old view of multisensory processing was that sensory processing happened in semi-rigid compartments in different parts of cortex. But it's becoming increasingly clear that senses influence one another at multiple stages. So today we're going to talk about three different types of multisensory processing to help give you a sense of all of the ways that our sensory systems can interact. So the first of these are multisensory or cross-modal associations. These are situations in which inputs from one sense remind us of qualities of another sense. So let's start with a thought experiment. While traveling, you find yourself in a part of the world where you don't speak the language and you have no guidebook or dictionary. You meet some friendly people and they try to teach you their language. They point to some objects and tell you their names, but you weren't quite paying attention and you didn't catch which is which. You know that one of these objects is called a muba and one is called a kiki. Which one is which? So most people would label the spiky one kiki and the curvier one muba. How come? Well, maybe you're thinking something like, it's kiki's like sharp and jagged, and the sound kiki is like sharp and jagged. So maybe you're saying it's something about the shape of the objects. But let's get shape out of the picture. Which of these is kiki, and which of these is muba? Now they're both round. Yeah, so most people would call the lemon kiki and the hot cocoa muba. So sharp things are kiki, and sour things are kiki? All right, let's use another example. How about this sound? Versus this one. Yeah, so most people would say that the flute is kiki, right? So kiki is maybe sharp and sour and like high-pitched and staccato. So isn't this interesting that we have these shared intuitions about certain words sound like certain things? But it's important to note that like kiki and muba, those words, they're just sound waves. They're just patterns of pressure moving through the air. So why does muba remind us of a hot cocoa and a bassoon rather than lemonade and a flute? So these are what we refer to as multisensory associations. People associate specific sensory attributes with one another and use qualities from one sense to describe experiences in other senses. We'll talk a little bit more later on and in the problem set about where these associations come from and why we have the ones that we do. Okay, our second stop in our multisensory processing journey is at multisensory integration, how we integrate information from multiple senses together. So many of our perceptual experiences are multisensory. So right now I'm talking to you and you can see my face and you can hear my words. When you eat food, you both taste it and smell it and feel it in your mouth. So for something to demonstrate multisensory integration, you have to get input from multiple sensory systems simultaneously. This is different from multisensory associations, which are just things in one sense that are reminding us of things in another sense, not the combined experience of multiple senses simultaneously. So let's work through a few examples of ways that one sensory system can influence another. We're going to start with probably my favorite example of multisensory processing. It's one that I've done some research on in my lab too. So I'm going to show you a video of a person saying something, and I want you to first just look and listen and tell me what you think the person is saying.
Ba, ba, ba.
Let's watch it again.
Ba, ba, ba.
Okay, now close your eyes and just listen, and I'm going to play the exact same clip.
Ba, ba, ba. Ba, ba, ba.
Okay, so most people report perceiving fa or va when they're looking at the screen and ba when they're just listening, even though it's the exact same clip both times. So this is the McGurk effect. The video is an image of a person saying fa spliced with an audio track of them saying ba. We combine the information from what we hear and what we see to arrive at a perception of va or sometimes fa. So this is a classic and really robust illusion that nicely demonstrates that what you hear can be influenced by what you see. Let's look at another example of audiovisual integration. This is known as the motion bounce illusion. I want you to watch the two dots, the dot at point A and the dot at point B, and try to figure out where they end up. Where does the dot at point A end up? Most people would say on the lower left. Okay, now watch the same thing again, but with one small change. Now, where does the dot on the left end up? So in that case, people are more likely to say that dot A ends up on the lower right. So in the first video, when you heard that click, people are more likely to report that the dot that starts in the top left ends up in the bottom left. The click gives the impression of a ricochet. But when there's no sound, we have a different set of expectations that objects follow straight lines unless we have some reason to believe that they're not. So the dot on the top left ends up on the bottom right. So what we've heard influences how we interpret the visual scene. So we'll talk about multisensory integration in each of our sensory systems. Okay, our final stop through the land of multisensory processing is a condition called synesthesia. And I want you to first hear about synesthesia from someone who has it.
It's just sort of always been just the way I think. It's just one has always been yellow, you know, certain letters have always been certain colors.
The days of the week are pretty, well, they're terribly consistent. Monday is red. And my mother said when I was 5 years old, No, Monday's blue, blue Monday.
Onions were pink, beer is blue, so peas are purple.
And so basically I associate most letters and all numbers with some sort of color. One alone by itself is yellow, but four is also yellow, but it's a more golden yellow. Some of the differences are very, very subtle, but there are definitely distinct differences in my mind.
So synesthesia is a condition in which perception of one stimulus leads to a perceptual experience in another sense. So we call the stimulus that triggers the experience the inducer, and the additional experience is referred to as the concurrent. So Tiffany says one is yellow, one is therefore the inducer, and yellow is the concurrent. That means that when Tiffany sees a black number one, she has a simultaneous perceptual experience of yellowness. Now, the subjective synesthetic experience differs along a continuum from projectors who report actually seeing the colors projected onto the page, to associators who consistently associate letters or numbers with particular colors in this example, but report experiencing them kind of in their mind's eye. So synesthesia is a really fascinating condition that demonstrates the extent to which our perceptual experience can differ from one another, and helps us understand something about typical perception as well. So let's look at a few other kinds of synesthesia. One of the most common forms of synesthesia is what Tiffany described, grapheme color synesthesia, in which letters or numbers are associated with colors. Now, within individuals, the concurrents are extremely consistent. So if one is yellow for Tiffany, it always will be. But the specific concurrents that people have tend to be variable across individuals. So just because one is yellow for Tiffany, it may be blue for somebody else. This is an interesting schematic that shows the concurrence that different synesthetes have for different letters. So each column is a letter, all the A's are in the first column, and each row is a person. So for four people in the sample, A is black, but for some it's pink, for many it's red, and so forth. And there are some consistencies. So you see that I and O and X and Z tend to be black and white, but otherwise there's lots of variability across individuals. Another form of synesthesia is called lexical gustatory synesthesia, and it occurs when people associate particular words with particular flavors. So for one synesthete, the word jail is experienced as cold, hard bacon. And these associations may be pleasant, like warm chocolate cake, or unpleasant. One synesthete described particular street signs that tasted of earwax. Interestingly, these associations tend to be limited by things that synesthetes experienced early in development. For example, one synesthete reported having no synesthetic associations with coffee or curry, even though he eats them regularly as an adult. Conversely, he often experiences certain breakfast cereals and candies that he ate as a child as concurrents, but which are no longer sold and he hasn't had in years. In a similar case, there's another synesthete who spoke English and French early in life and learned Spanish later. And he has concurrence for the early languages he learned, but not for Spanish that he learned later. So this suggests that these associations develop early in life and are constrained by these developmental experiences. Another form of synesthesia is called ordinal linguistic personification. In this form of synesthesia, letters are associated with personalities and human traits. So here's how one synesthete described numbers. He said, 4 is a warm, even-tempered puppy dog kind of guy, a Labrador, if you will. He likes being outdoors and gives really good hugs. He recycles and rides bikes, but isn't all up in your face about it. 8 is a mom. She's stable, plump, even-tempered, caring, and generally happy. She and number 2 are besties. Ordinal linguistic personification synesthetes really have these complex characters that are associated with letters and sometimes numbers as well. Number form synesthetes have associations between days, months, and other form of time and physical space. So here's an example of how one synesthete arranges the months of the year mentally. There's also pain color synesthetes, in which people report seeing colors when feeling pain, and many other forms as well. Synesthesia is a really fascinating condition, and I'm sure you have lots of questions about why and how we know, some of which we'll talk about in class. But one of the things that is so fascinating about synesthesia is how hard it can be for people without it to understand what it could possibly be like to have it, right? But what's really striking is that this is always the case for perception. I don't know what it's like to have grapheme color synesthesia, and it's really hard for someone else to explain the perceptual reality of it to me. But frankly, you don't know what lilacs smell like to me. It might be really different from what you experience, the same way not having synesthesia is different from having it. So these perceptual experiences that we have are in some ways really all our own. We each walk in our own perceptual worlds. But here are some of the things that we do know about synesthesia. It's relatively rare, but you certainly know people who have it. It's hard to get firm rates of incidence because some people who have it don't realize that they do. I've had students in this class come up to me after class looking kind of shaken, being like, what? I thought everybody had this. Do I have synesthesia? So synesthetes are more likely to be female and left-handed than you would expect by chance. And there appears to be some genetic component to it. But family members don't necessarily agree on, for instance, the color of graphemes more than unrelated synesthetes do. So it seems that what is running in families is the presence of synesthesia, but not the particular associations that people have, or even the particular type. So synesthetes with lexical gustatory synesthesia may have relatives with grapheme color synesthesia. So the genetic differences appear to convey like a susceptibility to synesthesia, but don't specify the presence or absence in a very deterministic way. Okay, finally, let's watch a short video from synesthesia expert David Eagleman about the potential causes of synesthesia.
So the most popular theory to explain synesthesia is that in different areas of the brain, you actually have cross-wiring. You have more wiring in a synesthetic brain that causes these areas to talk to each other more. I don't favor that theory. Instead, I favor a second hypothesis, which is that the amount of wiring is the same in everybody's brain. Instead, what's different is there's a slight difference in the balance of excitation and inhibition, such that activity here will cause activity here, because there's not enough inhibition of that activity. The reason I favor the hypothesis that the wiring is the same in everybody is because non-synesthetes can experience synesthesia. So for example, when people take drugs like LSD or DMT, they'll experience synesthesia. Also, many non-synesthetes, when they're very fatigued, right when they're falling asleep, somebody might slam a door and they'll see colors. So this implies that everybody is capable of a synesthetic experience. Also, for synesthetes, the amount of their experience waxes and wanes. So for example, when they are drunk with alcohol, or they're very tired, or they're very emotional or stressed out, their synesthesia tends to be much richer and more intense. And in other cases, when they're on certain drugs like antidepressants, their synesthetic experience goes down. And this has the feeling of something that is involved in inhibition in the brain rather than wiring, because there's no reason to expect that your wiring would change based on emotion and fatigue and so on.
So here's what I want to leave you with today. No sense is an island. We're going to spend the rest of term talking about each sensory system in turn, but we'll be keeping in mind the interconnected nature of these senses throughout. I'll see you in class. All right, there are tons of great examples for these. I'll be excited to see and hear what you came up with. So where do these associations come from? Well, opinions differ, but here are two theories, neither of which fully explains the phenomenon. One theory is that stimuli across senses are associated with shared patterns of neural code that make them seem similar to one another. So for example, high intensity stimuli tend to lead to rapid firing of action potentials in all sensory systems. So loud things seem similar to heavy or strong things because all of those cause a fast rate of action potentials. Another possibility is that similarities in the affective value of experiences may lead to multisensory associations. So things that are soft and warm and sweet are all nice. Those signal safety. They make us feel good. So velvet and hot cocoa seem more similar than velvet and lemons, right? Because velvet is muba. So things that are unpleasant can also become linked because they're dangerous or aversive. Things that are really cold or really sharp or really sour, all of those can have similar connotations because we want to avoid all of them. Okay, we'll talk about lots of examples of this throughout the course. Coming up, we're going to talk about how what you smell and hear and see and touch all affect your perception of flavor. And a bit later in term, we'll talk about how what you see and how you sense gravity and how you feel your body in space all affect your ability to balance. All right, so why integrate? Well, senses can provide redundant information to one another, which may be particularly beneficial if one sense is lost or impaired. So indeed, people can get some information about what people are saying just from watching talking faces, and lip reading is particularly helpful to people when they lose their hearing. Senses can also provide complementary information. So in the case of the motion bounce illusion, the visual input is consistent with either the ricocheting interpretation or the passing through interpretation, and the click gives a clue about which of those it is. Senses can also facilitate generalization across situations. If I can make a guess about what something will taste like by looking at it, we might be able to save ourselves from putting unpleasant things in our mouths. Right. As one example of this idea of generalization, I want to show you a great visual that went viral a couple of years ago called the skipping pylons. Does watching this make you hear something? Even if it doesn't quite make you hear something, can you imagine what it would sound like? So even though you've never seen these big electrical things do jump rope, many people report having a strong intuition about what it would sound like, or even that they actually hear it. It's a great example of making cross-sensory predictions based on our experience with multisensory associations. Okay, so one difference from multisensory associations is that synesthetic concurrents occur automatically and involuntarily. So we can reason out Kiki and Muba, but those things don't automatically spring into mind when you see those shapes, right? You don't see that shape, that spiky shape that I showed you in the video and say, that's Kiki, right? You have to kind of think about it and reason it out. Another big difference is the consistency of the associations. So I mentioned before that synesthetes are more consistent than non-synesthetes in which concurrents go with which inducers. But I don't just mean to say that, like, if I say A is red today, I'll say A is red tomorrow. We can measure consistency in a much more fine-grained way. So in one study, researchers gave synesthetes and non-synesthetes letters and asked them to identify the exact color in continuous color space that they associate with each letter. They asked the control participants to fake synesthesia. That is, they said, try to be as consistent, use memory strategies, and try to match your answers across trials. What the researchers found is that the synesthetes were far more consistent than the controls. So in this graph, zero means the color value was like identical down to the pixel. And you can see that the synesthetes were far more consistent than the controls. In fact, there's like no overlap between them. So even if the control participants have the kind of intuitive sense that some letters are like some colors, the associations tend not to be automatic and involuntary, and they are much less consistent than they are for people who actually have synesthesia. We can also see behavioral consequences of the presence of synesthesia as well. We can test predictions about synesthesia using information about how people perform particular types of tasks. So If, for instance, I show you this display and I ask you to count how many twos there are, I can time you and I can see how long it takes you to find them. If you are a grapheme color synesthete that has different color concurrence for number 2 and number 5, the display is going to look more like this to you. So synesthetes end up being faster than controls on tasks like this if the colors distinguish between items. If you happen to be a synesthete for whom 2s and 5s are both yellow, this wouldn't help. We can also see empirical evidence for synesthesia from neuroimaging research. So here we have images of representative brains of a synesthete and a control from this particular study. So this is the brains shown from beneath as if we're like looking up from under the brain. The front of the brain is at the bottom of the slide. So previous research has established a region of the brain called V4 that is important for color perception. And we'll talk more about that when in the unit on vision. And other regions that are important for processing text. So the heat map that's shown here, the orange and red color, are the regions that are activated in this study when the synesthete and the control are shown black and white text. And what you may notice right in here is that this is the region that is that's associated with processing colors. The synesthete is using color processing regions even when they aren't being presented with any colors on the screen. So they are using the regions of their brain that are typically activated by color processing, even when they're just looking at something that's black and white. The control participant, unlike the synesthete, does not. Pretty cool, right? One more thing on consequences. There's more consistency than you would expect by chance in the reported strengths and weaknesses that synesthetes have. The reasons for these aren't exactly clear, but there are some theories about the superior memory of synesthetes, that they have an additional method for forming associations because they have these, for instance, color associations with particular items. So if you ask a non-synesthete to remember an arbitrary string of numbers, it may be really hard. But for a synesthete who has a more multimodal and richer associations with those numbers, they may be able to do it more easily. All right, let me know if you have any questions. I look forward to hearing from you.